The McCone Files by Marcia Muller, narrated by Susan Boyce. The Last Open File. The big Victorian, slumped between its neighbors on a steeply sloping side street in San Francisco's Bernal Heights district, tall, shabby, and strangely welcoming in spite of its sagging roofline and blistered chocolate paint. I got out of my battered red MG and studied the house for a moment, then cut across the weedy triangular park that bisected Cozo Street and climbed the front steps. A line of pigeons roosted on the peak above the door. I glanced warily at them before slipping under and obeying a hand-lettered sign that told me to walk right in. It seemed an unnecessary risk to leave one's door open in the low-rent area, but when I entered, I came face to face with a man sitting at a desk. He had fine features and a goatee, and was dressed in the flannel shirt and Levi's uniform of the predominantly gay Castro district. Although his dark eyes were mild and friendly, he was scrutinizing me very carefully. I presented my business card, one of the thousand I'd had printed on credit at my friend Daphne's and Charlie's shop, and his expression became less guarded. "You're Sharon McCone, Hank's detective friend," he exclaimed. I nodded, although I didn't feel much like a detective anymore. For the past few years, I'd worked under the license of one of the city's large investigative firms. The day I'd received my own ticket from the State Department of Consumer Affairs, my boss had fired me for insubordination. At first, I'd seen it as an opportunity to strike out on my own, but operating out of my studio apartment on Guerrero Street was far from an ideal situation. Jobs were few, I was about to run out of cards, and my rent was due next Thursday. Yesterday, I'd run into Hank Zahn, a former housemate from my college days at UC Berkeley. He'd asked me to stop by his law firm for a talk. I'd hoped the talk would be about a job, but from the looks of this place, I doubted it. The man at the desk seemed to be waiting for more of a response. Inanely, I said, "Yes," to reinforce the nod. He got up and stuck out his hand. "Ted Smalley, secretary, janitor, and occasionally court jester. Welcome to All Souls Legal Cooperative." I clasped his slender fingers, liking his smile. "Hank's in conference with a client right now," Ted went on. "Why don't you make yourself comfortable in the parlor?" He motioned to his right, at a big blue room with a fireplace and a butt-sprung maroon sofa and chair. "I'll tell him you're here." I went in there, noting an old-fashioned upright piano and a profusion of books and games on the coffee table. A tall chefflera grew in the window bay. Its pot was a pink toilet. I sat on the couch, and immediately a coil of spring prodded my rump. Moving over, I glared at where it pushed through the upholstery. "Make myself comfortable? Indeed." Ted Smalley had disappeared down the long central hall off the foyer. I looked around some more, wondering what the hell Hank was doing in such a place. Hank Zahn was a Stanford grad and had been at the top of his law school class at Berkeley's Bolt Hall. When I'd last seen him, he was packing his belongings prior to turning over his room in the brown shingled house we'd shared on Durant Street to yet another in an ongoing chain of tenants that stretched back into the early 60s, and for all I knew, continued unbroken to this very day. At the time, he was being courted by several prestigious law firms, and he joked that the salaries and benefits they offered were enough to make him sell out to the establishment. But Hank was a self-styled leftist and social reformer, a Vietnam vet weaned from the military on Berkeley's radical politics. Selling out wasn't within his realm of possibility. I could envision him as a public defender, or an ACLU lawyer, or a loner in private practice. But what was this cooperative business? As I waited in the parlor, though, I had to admit the place had the same feel as the house we'd shared in Berkeley.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.